Hi, this is Tamsin Granger.
Dan Abuhoff.
With Tamsin and Dan Read the Paper. It's Sunday, July 15th, the day after Bastille Day.
Right.
2018. And we've got a lot going on this week. All manner of discussions of Oscar Hammerstein, SpongeBob, the Yankees, what's happening with the vaults in Indian temples, what's going on in the garden, can you swim in the Hudson? So let's get right to it. What did we do yesterday?
Is this a quiz? We went to the Hammerstein event, the big event in Doylestown at, Highland Farm?
Yes, it was a sing-along.
Sing-along, of course.
We went. This was a recommendation of Armand Evers,
right.
Our favorite bartender.
Right.
At the marvelous Dionys.
So Armand says to us, they're doing a sing-along of Oscar Hammerstein songs at Highland Farm in Doylestown, which is where Hammerstein lived for many years. And the place is being restored, and they're gathering people to sing Hammerstein songs.
Now, we don't always take Armand's advice.
No.
He's often telling us to do wacky things.
Especially like when...
We ought to both have... What are those motorcycles called?
Vespas.
Vespas. We ought to buy Vespas.
He's never said I should. He said you should have a Vespa.
I mean, we once took his advice the first time we met him when we said, what side should we have, broccoli or pasta?
Yeah, that's about it.
And he looked at us and said, broccoli.
Okay, he's been on a roll. Yeah, so in any event.
But this time we decided to follow his advice.
Right. And we went, and even though he didn't go, so that gave us pause. But we were there, and Tamsin cleverly said, notwithstanding my objections, that we have to be there early because there'll be a big crowd. And I said, who would go to this? It's from 11:30 to 2 o'clock. It's going to be a bright, sunny, hot afternoon. Who's going to gather to sing Oscar Hammerstein songs? We can waltz in any time we want. And I couldn't have been more wrong. We got there a little bit early.
Well, it was all of our buddies. It was everybody from the small theaters. It was everybody from the Mo Berg movie,
yeah,
really.
Everyone who goes to the Doylestown movie theaters and watches old movies.
We were, as usual, the youngest people there.
It was a well-seasoned crowd. And we got there on time, early, got a very good seat. And they had a kind of interesting program put together. They had a bunch of singers lined up.
Let's set the stage.
Yeah, sure, what?
Doylestown is in Bucks County. Bucks County happens to be where a lot of New Yorkers were hanging out in the 40s and 50s, etc. Hammerstein renovated a farmhouse at a lovely estate with a swimming pool, tennis court.
No, you're sugarcoating this. Hammerstein's career wasn't going well in 1940. He had success with Jerome Kern in Showboat, but he was down on his luck when he bought the place in 1940. He didn't buy a palace as a big success. It's after he buys the place in 1940 that he meets with Richard Rodgers, and then it gets going.
Daniel, it's called the Genius Belt.
It's the Genius
All
Belt.
All kinds of people.
It became the Genius Belt.
Dorothy Parker, Moss Hart.
After he bought that place. But the point is, he was part of the firm.
It was a cool place to be.
He was an early adopter. He was one of the first ones there. It wasn't a Genius Belt when he got there. It was just the farm. And once he lured Richard Rodgers out there and they became a partnership, then it became the Genius Belt because of all the great successes that came from their musical theater enterprises. And, you know, they were legion. So they were, what, in order, Oklahoma being the first one, huge success.
We're doing them in order?
Can you do them in order?
No, I can't do them in
I'll
order.
I'll do them in order.
And you've already left out Showboat.
Showboat was with Jerome Kern. Follow. Once he got with Richard Rodgers, it was Oklahoma, which is the one which got them going. I think from memory, I can probably do it. It's Carousel. Let's see, The King and I. It's South Pacific. South Pacific maybe before The King and I. And then, of course, it's Maria. It's
Sound of Music.
Sound of Music.
Okay.
That's right.
That's fabulous, dear. So we went to the sing-along.
Right.
Notwithstanding, we rarely sing.
We rarely sing. Well, I don't sing.
We actually rarely sing Hammerstein, Rodgers and Hammerstein.
You used to.
I would sing more Rodgers and Hart
than Rodgers and Hammerstein. When I first met you, there was a lot of talk about Nellie Forbush, the protagonist.
101 Pounds of Fun.
There you go.
But anyway, so we enjoyed that. But what we really enjoyed, they had local performers.
Right.
who sometimes performed a song,
right,
or sometimes led us in the singing.
Both.
And so that was really, there were some great young talents there. There was a spectacular rendition of Old Man River,
right,
by Keith Spencer, mm-hmm, who also sang some songs with his wife. Give me a minute here.
Well, you'll get it. But there's a whole bunch of folks there who were, you know, who are either teachers in the area or up
performers, or even students.
There
were a bunch of young people.
But they're
there
not.
As well.
It's not big stars, but a lot of people who sang extremely well, and a couple of local folks who were not pros who sang a little less well.
So we sat there under the trees,
right,
looking at Oscar's wonderful house.
Right.
We were right below the window from which he looked, writing, "Oh, what a beautiful morning."
Mm-hmm.
And it was quite, it was fun. It's one of those fun things that you're doing. You kind of have this sense of community with this group of people. Hammerstein's grandson was there, great-grandson was there, et cetera. So it was a fantastic.
Yeah,
afternoon.
Well, yeah, absolutely. And look, you're selling yourself short. Tams is a super singer. So you could do a lot worse than having Tams and Granger sing to you in the course of, the day. Hello, young lovers, getting to know you. I'm just a girl, can't say no. You can just imagine.
But so, one of the highlights was
when
they had men from the audience come up front.
Oh, that was not a highlight.
It was a highlight.
It was awful.
And
it was awful.
Sing There Is Nothing Like a Dame.
No, the only thing worse than that was when they had the women come up and sing How Do You Solve a Problem Like Maria? How Do You Hold a Moonbeam in Your Hands?
Okay, all right. You're just being cranky
here. Look, you know something? It was late at that point. It was 2.5 hours in and it was 92 degrees. So that was... tougher to take, but it was
so that was fun.
And you know something, the Hammerstein stuff is legitimately interesting. They passed out, or we picked up a program near the end, and there are all these little stories about Hammerstein composing or writing the words for Mr. Rogers' compositions in Highland Park at his standing desk using the yellow pad. And they're just funny stories. I mean, first of all, there's the testimonials. There's Stephen Sondheim about Highland Farm, says he, in the first afternoon he spent on Highland Farm, he said, I learned more about songwriting in the musical theater than most people learn in a lifetime, which is probably true. And we've heard Stephen Sondheim talk about growing up with Oscar Hammerstein.
So it was fun to be there
but the
grass on which Sondheim had at some point trod.
Yeah, exactly. But they also start, of course, with Oh, What a Beautiful Morning, in which the great line is, the corn is as high as an elephant's eye. It's a line, if there's any line that anybody knows in American show tunes, it's that line.
Yeah.
And they have an explanation as to how that line comes about. Apparently, this is Hammerstein's writing. He said, I first wrote, the corn is as high as a cow pony's eye, after looking out in the fields. Then I walked over to my neighbor's cornfield and found that his corn was much higher. Sounds like Hammerstein. So then we got Elephant's Eye. So it's kind of a stunning connection. And we did have a good time. And it is an interesting community event. And it's a big deal. So
all right.
I enjoyed it. So that was yesterday.
That was yesterday.
A unique event.
Yeah. Hard to beat that. So, you know, here we are out in the country. We're not glamping. But we're out in the country drinking in nature.
Right.
And so it makes me think about nature and gardens, etc. And in the New York Times, what's it called? The review section, which is a bunch of op-ed type pieces. There's a piece by a lawyer, Huma Yazin, who writes about how she enjoys gardening and how it reduces stress. It teaches her children the value of patience and hard work and vegetables, etc. None of it very new, but she does refer to a couple of studies that are kind of interesting that we've been hearing about for about 10 years or so, and that is there are literally beneficial bacteria in the dirt, in the soil,
mm-hmm,
seem to activate your brain, give you more vitality, and act as an antidepressant.
Really?
It certainly does. They've done studies with mice. It works for the mice.
Really?
They're pretty sure works for people. And in the process of activating your brain, it also seems to activate immune responses. So it has tremendous sort of psychological, emotional, and physiological benefits. So get out there in the garden, okay? Next I came across an article about forest bathing.
Yeah.
So forest bathing, no need to worry. You're not actually, undressing in the forest. I don't know, maybe some of the forest bathers do, but it's actually a thing, okay? Going into the forest and being at one with nature, again, decreases stress, maybe it improves your heart rate. There's actually an association of nature and forest therapists, and you can get a degree in leading people in forest bathing. I've actually known of a forest bathing guide, Nina Smiley up at Mohonk Mountain House. So again, we're already feeling that there's a real benefit to being around nature, but now it's scientific. And again, on that note, the value of gardens and gardening, there's a new book out, a memoir by Penelope Lively. A collection of essays, really, about her musings and those of other gardeners and thinkers and authors, etc., about the values of gardening, getting your hands dirty. Okay, so that's Life in the Garden by Penelope Lively. Interestingly enough, the review of this book in the Wall Street Journal is by someone we know, Barbara Paul Robinson, who's a retired lawyer, but also quite the avid gardener and the author of several books on gardening herself. And in fact, I think by accident, our friend Lisa Walsh ran into her at a garden retreat kind of thing up in the woods.
I should indicate a former law partner, so a lawyer, the best kind of lawyer.
Not just a partner. I mean, wasn't she president of the New York Bar or something?
Yes.
A superstar on many levels. And who knows? It may be that beneficial bacteria that stimulated. Her great career. Life in the Garden, she says, feels like a fascinating conversation with a valued friend. The author grows philosophical as she thinks about time and how gardens provide refuge and escape from the press of daily existence. Okay, and there's a great quote from the book where she's talking about a scene in the play by Tom Stoppard, Arcadia. Which she calls a glorious play. And I have to agree. Yeah. I love that play. And the lady of the manor is told that she might advertise in the newspaper for a garden hermit, which apparently is all the rage in landscape gardening at the time. The lady replies, "Surely a hermit who takes the newspaper is not a hermit in whom one might have complete confidence."
That's Stoppard.
Somebody who's reading the paper is not really considered a hermit, I think. Finally, on our fabulous garden update here, I have just reread a favorite book, Elizabeth and Her German Garden. Mm-hmm. And that book was written in 1898. And it was written by a pip of a woman, Elizabeth von Arnim, A-R-N-I-M, Australian-born British author. She was born in 1866. She dies in 1941. She marries a Prussian aristocrat. And this is a story, a memoir of her being on this estate and finding more solace and companionship in the garden than with all of the people inside the big fabulous house. She complains about her guests. She details her husband, whom she refers to as the man of wrath, holding forth with all his great theories about men and women and how, you know, life works. It's unbelievable that it's over 100 years old. She seems completely up to date. This book totally surprised her publisher and has to be reprinted 20 times within the first year.
Really?
And she goes on to write quite a few other books, including Enchanted April.
Which was a miniseries,
apparently was a play and a musical.
Really?
Yeah, okay. I don't even remember seeing that. But I was looking for info of that. She marries again. Well, actually, while she's married to the Prussian, she has three children, and their tutors include E.M. Forster and Hugh Walpole.
Really?
After she leaves the Prussian, the Prussian dies. I'm not sure exactly the sequence. She has several years' affair with H.G. Wells.
Really?
Then she marries a British publisher. That falls apart. She heads to the United States, embarks on an affair with a man 30 years her junior.
Okay.
Keeps you young.
Yeah.
She was about 54 at the time. He's, you know, do the math. And who eventually marries somebody else, but names his first child Elizabeth after her and has fond memories of her. So she will eventually, she'll be back and forth between Europe and the U.S. She will actually die from the flu in the 40s in Charleston, South Carolina. Oh, by the way, she also wrote a book called Mr. Skeffington. Does that sound familiar?
It does. But what's
the also a movie with Betty Davis and Claude Rains.
But what's the name of the book we're talking about again?
The book is Elizabeth and Her German Garden.
Yeah. Okay.
So
never heard of that.
No.
Okay. Good. Good. All right. Well, that's a lot of gardening information, but good.
Good and good for you.
Yes. Okay. Well, let's talk about something that's bad and bad for you. Well, not really, but here's a trend that's kind of, you know, some people go for it, some people won't. And that is that restaurants are turning their restaurant into workspace, at least during the day. In other words, it is common, people might say, I'm going to go to a coffee house, coffee shop.
I'm going to go to Starbucks, Panera,
and sit there with my laptop hours and hours. Well, right. Now they're making it official. Now you have restaurants who are contracting with an organization called Spacious. And Spacious comes into the restaurant and says, look, you're not doing much lunch business anyway. Here's what we do. We will run the place during the day for you. You do your normal dinner business. But during the day, we will set out all these cords and power strips and all these big common tables.
Set up a coffee stand.
Right.
And
it's a workspace.
You know, amenities.
And people come in and work. And they do it per a contract. Let's say a monthly contract. So you're a member for $99 a month. You can go to your office being this restaurant. You come and you sit down and you're guaranteed a spot. You can plug in all your devices and sip coffees to your heart's content and spend 8 hours there.
Right.
That's the deal.
Right. So what do you think of that?
It makes sense. It makes sense in a lot of ways. Look, I haven't done the math. I haven't crunched the numbers. Obviously, someone's figured out.
Well, $99 is well worth it. It's got to be better than working in Starbucks, right?
You know, it clearly makes sense for the purpose of the person like me who might walk in and use the space. It's an easy sell. You don't want to sit at home. You want to sit with a bunch of people. You want to have coffee. You want to be out and about. You're going to be more stimulated. You're going to be worth more.
Yeah, you're not going to be playing with the cat when you should be.
Right. And you're going to be, you're not going to be looking over your shoulder saying the people at Starbucks want me to leave. I mean, you're there and you're all set up. The question is, does it work from the restaurant's perspective? Because they're collecting, you know, a high percentage of $99 a month for, I don't know, from 40 people. And does that make the economic work for them or not? I haven't looked at the numbers. Apparently it does.
Well, I went online to the company's website, Spacious, and they've got some very high-end spots there, some pretty nice New York restaurants.
Right, they have it in San Francisco and New York.
And it would be lovely to be sitting there doing work and, you know, more cheery, I think. And a lot cheaper than some of these other options like WeWork. So
no, again, it's an
WeWork,
easy.
You pay $300 or $400 for a spot.
It's an easy sell for me, the worker. Get that. The question is, does it work for the restaurant to turn over their space? And that I don't know. But there has to be a middle ground in which you make it work. And they talk about people who are just walking along, you know, someplace in Manhattan, and they just see all these people working, and they knock on the door. They say, "What's going on?"
Yeah.
And they explain, and they sign up. It's an easy sell. Right. Anyway, it's a productive use of space, and you're going to see
more. The only question is if it's risky at all, having people, other people in your restaurant.
I don't think so. You're not handling a lot of money. I think it makes...
No, but what if people get into things they shouldn't get into?
Like what?
The food, the bar.
I think you can handle that. I think it's gonna, you're going to see a lot more of it.
Okay, so that's an interesting trend. Yeah. Now, over in India, they're having a problem with the vaults in Hindu temples.
Really?
Yeah.
I was worried about that.
Specifically, there was a story in the New York Times this weekend about a temple in Puri, India, a 12th century temple to Lord Jagannath, important Hindu deity. And they tell a story about a group of archaeologists, priests, and government officials who are going to check the vault of the temple to see whether it's structurally secure. And in order to do this for security purposes, they all have to strip down to loincloths to make sure they're not stealing anything. Now, this is an old, old thing that temples, I mean, this goes back to the Greek temples, would store wealth in the temple. Sometimes the Greek temples, their colossal statue of the god would actually be gold leafed or plated, and that was actually storing the community's wealth in that statue, and you really can't carry it away too easily. Right. But here people make donations to the temple, and it's being stored in these vaults in temples all over India. There's an estimate by the World Gold Council that there could be as much as 8.8 million pounds of gold in Indian temples. Okay, so anyway, this group goes into the temple in Puri, heads for the vault, and comes out a little while later saying, well, as a matter of fact, we didn't have to actually go in the vault because we could see through the bars that everything was okay. Mm-hmm. Well, as it turns out, the government announces a little bit later that they couldn't get into the vault because they couldn't find the key. Mm-hmm. So there's a tradition of one key for these vaults, and it was nowhere to be found.
But they
meanwhile, there are all kinds of indications that some of the gold is missing, a lot of the gold is missing, etc. And perhaps some of the administration is not on the up and up with maintaining the gold. So this is a big crisis, and now the Indian government is making all kinds of, regulations.
A duplicate key, you said?
A little while later,
there
were reports of a duplicate key.
Right. So that's,
and people were saying, really? How could that be? When I worked there, there was never a duplicate.
Right. Okay.
This is not the way we do it. So it's really quite a controversy. By the way, this temple is a little bit famous because it has very strict rules about who can go in. You have to be not only a Hindu, but a particular level or type of Hindu. Indira Gandhi was not allowed in because her husband was a follower of Zoroastrianism. Mahatma Gandhi refused to go in because the temple barred some of the lower castes from being able to go in. So it's all very shocking and interesting, and let's hope they find the key and the gold.
Well, it sounds like they've got the key, but that's the problem. Someone's got the key, it's the wrong people. The okay, here's something that's interesting. A play I never thought I'd be talking about. SpongeBob SquarePants. Nothing wrong with SpongeBob SquarePants.
Which is closing soon, by the way.
It is, and I wonder why that is. It's being closed in September, and I thought it was successful. Why is it closing?
I don't know. I'm not privy to the
There's no explanation here why, but it's closing in the middle of September. You would have thought they're making money. But here's a problem with it. According to the Wall Street Journal, there is a fellow here who writes about management. His name is Sam Walker. And he said all his friends told him he must see SpongeBob SquarePants. It's all about management. So he goes to see it, and he's new to SpongeBob SquarePants, and he's impressed. It's a very engaging story.
Well, he does
story.
Take, a, takes an daughter. Expert with him. He
takes his daughter.
Nine-year-old daughter.
Yes. So the story is that Eugene Krabs, bear with me if you know all SpongeBob stuff. Eugene Krabs is the proprietor of Krusty Krab. And he tells SpongeBob he's not management material, therefore we're setting the stage for the big issue. Well, then there's a crisis in town. Mount Humongous begins rumbling. It's about to erupt. What's the town going to do?
So it's a volcano.
Right. Everyone's
going
panicking.
Going to destroy.
Yeah. Mount Humongous gets the point across. The point is that things look bad for Bikini Bottom, which is the name of the place we're talking about. And SpongeBob, though, finds himself talking to one Sandy Bottom. Sandy Bottom.
Well, because of this crisis, and the town is all trying to find, who's responsible. And they put the blame on Sandy.
Oh, is that right?
Who is
they put
a
the blame
squirrel
on her?
Scientist.
Well, she's...
okay,
she
doesn't have gills.
Yeah, she doesn't have gills.
She's a
minority member of the community, and she's played by an African-American actress. It turns out that Sandy Bottom explains to SpongeBob, not only is she not the problem, but she is the solution to the problem. And her solution is to use a small explosive device, which would relieve the pressure and prevent the kind of explosion that would really destroy the town. And with SpongeBob's help, they actually do...
save the town.
Implant the device.
Yeah.
Save the town.
And everybody thanks SpongeBob.
And SpongeBob is the hero.
Right.
And
of course, Krab says, because he has the management skills I always knew he had.
He said, but in any event, SpongeBob, triumphs. And they see him as the manager that he was thought not to be. And Sandy Bottom gets sort of a little bit of pat on the back, and she gets to keep her job. And that's the way it goes. And this fellow... who's writing for the journal, Sam Walker, says, whoa, 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 whoa. What's going on here? What's going on here is...
Because Sandy actually saves the day.
Right.
But SpongeBob takes all the credit.
So what kind of management is this? You've got a guy who's a manager who takes all the credit, gets all the credit, and you have the minority worker below who's the genius who figures out the problem, and she never gets the kind of exposure or advancement that she's entitled to. She just has to work on, she's the woman who just is behind the scenes. So this is the worst possible lesson that you could possibly have with respect to management and women generally.
Right.
So he says to his daughter, what did you get out of this? And she says, well... I think the moral of the story, this is the daughter saying, nobody believed in SpongeBob, but in the end, he saved the town. And the father says, but wasn't it Sandy who led the way? Yes, says the daughter. That was kind of weird. So the father says, why wasn't Sandy the hero? And the daughter replies, Dad, the musical is called SpongeBob.
Right.
There you have it. But, little bit of a problem.
Learning lessons on Broadway.
Yes. So keep that in mind. Maybe that's why it's closing in September. I don't know.
Okay. So here's a shocking thing.
Yeah.
An article about a guy, Ira Gershenhorn.
Yes.
Who lives on the Upper West Side and goes for a daily swim in the Hudson River.
Gershenhorn. Good.
Rides his bike over to the river at like 104th Street. And jumps in and takes a swim.
This is called out of your mind. Yes.
Well, he's a computer programmer, but he's also a clean water advocate. So he is part of a group that actually tests the water in various locations. And he makes sure he takes water samples in the area where he swims to make sure it's okay. He says it's only really bad when there's a heavy storm and the sewer system overflows, can't handle.
So this is like right by Riverside Park, basically. Go in there.
Right. He hangs out in Riverside Park.
Oh, my God.
And jumps right in. He's also been part of a group that's been advocating for the creation of an actual sandy beach just south of the GW Bridge. And saying he's made presentations to the town council or whatever powers that be, and they haven't acted on it yet. In the non-swimming season, he's known as Lord of the Rings because he provides play equipment by the swinging rings in the park at 105th Street. Anyway, he seems like a brave and interesting guy. Yeah. It doesn't bother him to open his mouth or his eyes in the water, although he does say you can't see very much, which is good. And I feel the same way. You don't want, in these circumstances, to see what you're swimming with.
Listen, I haven't been there for a while. Years ago, when I was in law school, I used to run exactly by there. I used to get down 96th and go north. And you saw some wildlife you didn't want to see. Honestly to God.
He says it's completely swimmable.
Yeah, well, it wasn't in the water. It was the land that was the problem.
Okay. But, he also picks up trash along the way.
Good for him. All right, great. Great.
Hats off to Ira.
Oh, yes,
Gershenhorn, who's 66 years old. Maybe, you know.
Yeah, well, if he keeps going, well, we'll see. Good luck to him.
What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Yeah,
that will be the issue. There is an article in the Sunday Review section of the Times that's going to get a lot of attention.
What's the title of that article?
The title of the article is "The New York Yankees Are the Worst."
So I knew in a minute when I saw that paper that you would be drawn to that article.
Right, because I'm not a Yankee fan. But it's written by a guy named David Bentley Hart. He's the author of a book called The New Testament, A Translation. So
he's like a sports guy.
No. He may or may not be. But
he's a linguist.
No. He's a biblical scholar. The New Testament, A Translation. We'll go back to that. So what he does have at his disposal, apparently, is the language that's used in the New Testament. The apocalyptic language, which goes into great extremes about good and evil. And he uses all that to great effect in this article, describing the Yankees in over-the-top terms as incredibly evil. It's almost, comic book type images. And he's kidding, right? He certainly is to some degree. It is over the top, although the Yankee fans, some of them won't get it. There's something to it. He really does hate the Yankees, quite apart from all the saying that they're lined up with the evil powers and the forces of darkness. He's a Baltimore Oriole fan. And here's a little bit of what he's saying that's a little more down to earth. He says, the Yankees talk about their great tradition, intoning about solemn encounters in the temple of sport. And he says, this is ridiculous. No one likes the Yankees. No one wants to root for a team like the Yankees. The notion is appalling. Could any franchise be more devoid of romance? What has it ever represented but the brute power of money? As for the temple of sport, he says the temple of sport, more like the largest brothel in the world. When they tore down Yankee Stadium, they only tore it down because they wanted to build a larger, glitzier brothel across the street. Really, how does a Yankee fan's pride in all those purchased championships differ from the self-delusion of a man staggering out of a bawdy house at dawn, complimenting himself on his magnificent powers of seduction? And I'm reading the most mild stuff in the article. It goes crazy from there. And he has a point, okay? It's over the top, but he has a point. And
wait a minute, who is this guy again?
I just read his
name. In case somebody wants to read it.
Well, I'll go back and find it. I got to turn the pages. But he is David Bentley Hart. And he has a point, and the point is this. The point is that the Yankees have always just exploited having more money and being a bigger market than any other team and basically bought their success year after year after year after year. And people might say, well, this year they did it differently, and here's a year where they nurtured their young talent. There are a few exceptions, to be sure. But there are exceptions to the rule. The Yankees just throw their weight around and throw their money around. And when they're dealing with a player who gives them a great deal of competition and challenges their supremacy, they sign him the next year. That's the way it works, generally speaking. So the Yankees' issues are just, are they signing the right people? And if it doesn't work out, they'll sign somebody else. Now, that's all within the rules. They're perfectly entitled to do that. And some people see that as the triumph of American capitalism or the problem of American capitalism. It's actually a lot more complicated than that. And in fact, what the writer of the article does as it goes on is he compares the evil of the Yankees with the problems with capitalism, with the problems with the administration, with the problems with Major League Baseball and why they're not attracting fans, all of which is incredibly off base. Doesn't know what he's talking about. But he's right about the Yankees in this way. You know, the Yankees aren't evil. You can't root against them because they're evil. Although I will say, you know, I do like the T-shirt that people generally wear. Say, you know, my favorite team is the Orioles. My second favorite team is whoever is playing the Yankees. You see those kind of T-shirts all over the place, and I understand it. But having said that, they're playing within the rules. That's the way baseball works. They allowed a team like the Yankees to operate that way, and they have nothing to apologize for. To me, they're just not interesting. Right? Okay. They're just not interesting.
And besides, what about the Mets? They spend plenty of money, and they never win.
The Mets don't spend plenty of money.
It seems like a lot.
To you, it seems like a lot, but they don't.
That's Bobby Bonilla's mother, it seems like.
Well, Bobby Bonilla is one of the few beneficiaries of the Mets doling it out. But that's the contrast. The Mets don't spend... Mets spend money...
Like, they don't spend money and they don't win.
No. The Mets spend money like other teams spend money. In other words, they don't spend like a big market team. They spend like an average market team, and there's nothing wrong with that. And they feel that's the way one ought to go about it. And frankly, it dovetails with their own financial interests. So it's not as if they're being, you know, particularly generous when they do that. The Yankees have a different model. The Yankees say, we're in the biggest market in the world. We'll spend twice as much as everybody else, and it'll probably work out for us.
So who reads this book? People who hate the Yankees or people who...
I don't think it's a book. It's
not a book, it's just an essay?
It's just an essay.
Oh, okay. I thought maybe you wrote a whole book.
No.
All right.
It's just an essay. But I'm telling you, they're going to get a lot of comment about that. A lot of comment.
Well, he seems to have... Well, anyway. Moving right along here. How about a little help in figuring out the wild and woolly world of perfume?
Yeah. Okay. How about it?
Well, the thing is, you know, not that I wear that much perfume, but I do wonder, you know, because they have all these different options of what kind of perfume to buy. Also, I've been wondering, you know, there's something called eau de toilette.
Yeah.
You know, which always comes up in my art history classes.
Right.
Because they're famous paintings, like Venus's toilette,
yeah,
meaning Venus is getting ready, you know, bathing.
Isn't that like perfume, only cheaper, basically?
Well, but anyway, but so the students are always seeing it as Venus's toilet.
Uh-huh, right.
And what could that possibly mean? And I will say to them, don't you know about toilet water? And they say, what?
Yeah, toilet water.
You know,
water,
what the dog drinks?
No. Right.
Eau de toilette.
Anyway, so
here I am to set you straight. This is from an article in the New York Times. Perfume. Okay, so what is perfume? Perfume is just a mix of some kind of natural oils, or, you know, but also sometimes not natural, but and a carrier like alcohol. So in perfume, the scented oil will be about 15 to 30%, and the rest is the alcohol or the carrier, and that's meant to really last all day.
Right.
And it really envelops you and the area around you. That area around you is called cillage. How far the smell goes,
right,
is really quite profound,
right,
in perfume.
Right.
Okay. Eau de parfum is a little bit lesser concentration, 15 to 20%. And most scents are actually released as eau de parfum. It's, you know, less expensive, less strong, less overwhelming. We also call this the EDP.
Okay.
Right? Eau de toilette is 5 to 15%.
Right.
It's lighter. Some people think of it as a daytime scent because it will probably wear off by the end of the day. Here's the funny thing.
Yeah.
It's alcohol, right? So the carrier is alcohol. So as the scent dissipates... because the alcohol evaporates, right? If you go to wash your hands or somehow dampen the area where you have applied the EDP or the eau de toilette, you may re-energize the smell, the scent. And so you may go wash your hands and say, wait a minute, that's, you know, what I put on this morning, because you've reactivated it with the water. Okay. Eau de cologne, I think kind of originally referred to masculine scent.
Right.
So that's what men wear. Now it's kind of generally used to mean a very light concentration, 2 to 4%.
Okay.
And something called eau fraîche is the least concentrated form. Very light, just when you want a dash of smell. So now you understand, and now you understand why they get less and less expensive in the lesser concentrations.
Good. All right, so we will...
Should you ever want to buy some for anybody you might know.
That's right. So we're going to close. We did notice that Nancy Sinatra passed away. That's Frank Sinatra's first wife. Frank was from Hoboken. I guess she was from Jersey City. They met when they were young. They were married for some time. They had three children. And what's interesting is that Frank, as many people know, led a tumultuous romantic life. He divorced Nancy at some point. He was with starlets, Ava Gardner, Mia Farrow, people like that. But according to the obituary in the Times, remained very close friends with Barbara Sinatra, and she was his confidant.
He would drop by for meals.
Right, and she would make meals.
And
she would make
big occasions. Right. She lived to be 101 years old. 101,
a very patient woman. But what's interesting, what it reminded us of, is that, you know, going back to Hammerstein, and one of the reasons that Hammerstein and Rogers were so big at the time.
Can I just say, what? She never remarries.
Oh, yeah. Because
he marries many times.
You saw the quote.
She never remarries, and why not?
She said, after Sinatra, you know, what can you do?
Right.
So, in any event, you know, one of the reasons the Rogers and Hammerstein songs were so big was because they were in popular culture. People perform them. Singers perform them. Sinatra performed them in a way that's not done now. They weren't just confined to the Broadway theaters. They were out and people were listening to them on the radio all the time.
Right. So when there was a hit musical, everybody would cover, all the stars and aspiring stars would cover the
songs
and favorite songs.
The Rogers and Hammerstein songs. So we'll close with, you know, a recording by Frank Sinatra of a song from The King and I called I Have Dreamed. And the interesting thing about this song is, it's first of all, I don't think there are two people could be as different as Frank Sinatra and Oscar Hammerstein, frankly. It's number one. And yet, this song, according to many Sinatra experts, I'll just quote one, Sid Marx is the name of the guy who became famous as a Sinatra expert and played his music all the time, is his answer to the question he always gets, what is the definitive Frank Sinatra recording? And he always says, this recording of I Have Dreamed. So we'll leave you with that. And until the next time, this is Dan Abuhoff.
And Tamsin Granger with Tamsin and Dan reading the paper.
Thank you.
I have dreamed that your arms are lovely. And I have dreamed what a joy you'll be. I have dreamed every word you whisper when you're close to me. How you look in the glow of evening. I have dreamed and enjoyed the view. In these dreams I've loved you so that by now I think I know. what it's like